Another theory, reflection and refraction from conductor surface, normal and oblique incidences, series on electromagnetic field theory, lecture number 4.41. Waves undergo reflection and refraction when they travel from one medium to another medium. Electromagnetic waves too obey Snell's laws. They also undergo reflection and refraction while moving from one medium to another medium. In the present session, the focus is on plane wave incidence on the plane surface of a perfect conductor. Both normal and oblique incidences are considered. To begin with, we consider normal incidence of a plane wave over the surface of a perfect conductor. To understand, to analyze the configuration, let us suppose the plane face of the perfect conductor is coinciding with z equal to 0 plane. Above z equal to 0, the entire region is free space. Below z equal to 0, it is perfect conductor. Here we can see incident wave. It is traveling normally towards the reflecting surface. Let us assume its direction is negative z. It falls over the conductor plane face and gets reflected. A part of it may get refracted. In the present case, it is absent. We will see it soon. For the time being, concentrate on the reflected wave. According to Snell's law, angle of reflection is equal to angle of incidence. Therefore, angle of incidence here is 0. Angle of reflection must be 0. So, reflected wave must be now traveling normally to the reflecting surface. Now we have two waves above the conductor surface. One incident traveling in negative z direction, another reflected traveling in positive z direction. Of course, they are over the same path. So, interference takes place, superposition takes place, resulting in standing wave pattern. So, above z equal to 0 plane, there comes into being a standing wave pattern with the formation of nodes and antinodes. What is total electric field? What is total magnetic field in front of the reflecting surface? This aspect we are going to find right now. Before going to that, let us concentrate on the refracted wave or transmitted wave. Below z equal to 0, perfect conductor is there. Entire region is filled with perfect conductor. Inside perfect conductor, field cannot exist. Field is 0. Without field, wave cannot be there. Therefore, wave cannot be there inside perfect conductor. So, refracted wave or transmitted wave is absent in the present case. So, we have only incident wave, reflected wave, and no transmitted wave. Now, to find field, total field in front of the reflecting surface, let us consider electric field in the incident wave, E incidence equal to EI e power j beta z. It is plus because wave is traveling in negative z direction. EI is amplitude. Similarly, E reflected. This is electric field in the reflected wave, ER e power minus j beta z. This is the wave traveling in positive z direction. Total field is E incidence plus E reflected. It becomes EI e power j beta z plus ER e power minus j beta z. Before going further, note electric field in the incident wave, electric field in the incident wave, for that matter, magnetic fields also, they are, because it's these are plane waves, these fields, they must be normal to direction of propagation, and hence they must be parallel to reflecting surface. So electric field, magnetic field, both are tangential, parallel to the reflecting surface. With this understanding, let us move further. ET, total electric field, is 0 at z equal to 0. Why? There is a boundary condition which says tangential component of electric field must be continuous across the interface. But here the interface is, on one side we have perfect conductor, on the other side we have free space. Inside perfect conductor, electric field is 0. So other side also it must be 0. Therefore, ET is 0 at z equal to 0. So now enforcing that condition, it comes out EI plus ER is 0, or EI is minus ER, or ER equal to minus EI. It means electric field in the reflected wave is opposite in direction when compared to direction of electric field in the incident wave. It can be stated as electric field undergoes a phase change of 180 degrees on reflection from the surface of a perfect conductor. So one conclusion, one serious point which we should never forget is ER equal to minus EI or EI equal to minus ER when reflection is from the surface of a perfect conductor. We can extend this further and conclude that HI equal to HR. Why? Direction of magnetic field is direction of propagation cross direction of electric field. Direction of propagation got reversed. Direction of electric field also got reversed. Both got reversed. Therefore, direction of magnetic field undergoes no phase change, no reversal happens. Therefore, HI equal to HR. So, from this analysis, important conclusions are tangential component of electric field undergoes phase reversal, whereas tangential component of magnetic field undergoes no phase reversal upon reflection from the surface of a perfect conductor. Now, we consider total electric field. Total electric field is sum of incident and reflected. Now, we know ER equal to EI minus sign is there. So, ultimately, we get 2J EI sine beta Z. This is in phasor form. It can be converted very easily into time domain. Similarly, HT. HT is magnetic field in the incident wave plus magnetic field in the reflected wave. But HR equal to HI. So, summation results in 2HI cos beta Z. This is in phasor form. It can be converted into time domain. Now, another important aspect here is ET involves sin beta Z. HT also involves cos beta Z. Sin beta Z, cos beta Z means along Z direction, there is a standing wave pattern. ET assumes 0 at Z equal to 0. It means electric field is 0 at Z equal to 0. So node formation takes place for electric field at the surface of a perfect conductor, and HT involves cos beta Z. Means at Z equal to 0, H assumes maximum value, maximum possible value. It means for H, anti-node exists at the reflecting surface. One more important point is when wave falls over the surface, certain currents flow over the conductor surface. What is the basis for this prediction? There is a boundary condition according to which across the interface of two different media, tangential component of magnetic field is discontinuous by an amount equal to surface current density. Surface current that exists over the interface. It implies whenever there is a discontinuity in the tangential component of magnetic field, there exists a current with current density being equal to amount of discontinuity in the tangential component of magnetic field. In the present case, magnetic field is non-zero above Z equal to 0. It is 0 below Z is 0. Here it is 0, here it is non-zero. So discontinuity is there. Because of this discontinuity, there must be certain current, surface current, with the density being equal to discontinuity in the tangential component of magnetic field. Tangential component of magnetic field above Z equal to 0 surface is HT. So surface current density equal to HT must be there. Now we consider various observations that can be made from the analysis which we have done right now. The tangential component of electric vector gets reflected with phase reversal, whereas that of magnetic vector gets reflected without phase reversal at the surface of a perfect conductor. In the direction normal to reflecting surface, there exists standing wave pattern which naturally involves no average power flow. Notice, in the present case, there is no refracted wave. So everything that is incident gets reflected. Conclusion is, amplitude of reflected wave is same as amplitude of the incident wave. Now, we have interference, we have superposition between two waves whose amplitudes are same. When amplitudes are same, the resulting standing wave pattern is a pure one. Pure one means there exists no power flow. If the interference is between two waves whose amplitudes are different, then the standing wave pattern still will be there, but it is not pure. There exists some power flow. In the present case, no power flow exists because it is pure standing wave. Pure standing wave is also characterized by nodes at zeros, antinodes at double the amplitude of incident wave or reflected wave. In the direction parallel to reflecting surface, there exists no traveling wave and consequently no power flow. This is surface. Perpendicular to the surface, standing wave pattern. Parallel, no standing wave pattern, no traveling wave too. The fields ET and HT in front of surface at Z equal to 0 can be observed. Already these are derived. There exists a surface current with the density K equal to HT amperes per meter over the surface of the reflecting conductor. Reflection coefficient, which is reflected wave amplitude by incident wave amplitude, it is -1, and the transmission coefficient is 0, because transmission coefficient means transmitted wave amplitude by incident wave amplitude. There is no transmitted wave. Perfect conductor means no refracted or transmitted wave, so transmission coefficient is 0. Now we move on to oblique incidence case. Under this case, we consider two situations. In one situation, the electric vector is normal to plane of incidence. In another situation, it is parallel to plane of incidence. What is plane of incidence? It is the plane containing the incident ray and normal to the surface. When the electric vector is normal to the plane of incidence, it is called perpendicularly polarized wave or horizontally polarized wave. When electric vector is parallel to the plane of incidence, it is called parallelly polarized wave or vertically polarized wave. In case of perpendicularly polarized wave, the electric vector is normal to plane of incidence and parallel to reflecting surface, whereas the magnetic vector is parallel to plane of incidence. In case of parallelly polarized wave, the magnetic vector is normal to plane of incidence and parallel to reflecting surface, whereas the electric vector is parallel to plane of incidence. How to draw ray diagram? To begin with, we have to remind ourselves the Snell's law of reflection. Draw incident and reflected waves. Here I want to remind you the fact that as the incidence is on the surface of a perfect conductor, there exists no transmitted wave, there exists no refracted wave. Reason is, inside conductor, there exists no field and hence no wave. Therefore, as far as analysis of incidence on the surface of a conductor is concerned, it involves only two waves, incident wave and reflected wave, no transmitted. What he says is, using Snell's law, draw incidence and reflected wave. Suppose incident wave is given like this. Reflected wave can be written, it can be sketched using the fact that angle of reflection is equal to angle of incidence. If the wave is perpendicularly polarized, draw E vector out of or into the incidence plane. This is incidence plane. Draw out of the plane of incidence. Out of the board is indicated by a dot inside a circle indicating arrow tip towards you. Or you can consider E vector into the board, into the plane of incidence. In such case, it is indicated by tail of the arrow into the board. If wave is parallelly polarized, draw H vector out of or into the plane of incidence. Now we have information regarding direction of propagation of the incident wave. From polarization of the wave, we have also the information pertaining to electric vector. Once these two pieces of information are available, we can sketch other field component. We can find the direction of other field component by using the fact that electric vector, magnetic vector, direction of propagation, these three vectors form a right-handed vector system. Now, using E or H vectors, phase reversal or no phase reversal at conductor surface, field direction in the reflected wave can be determined. So far we considered incident wave. Now come to reflected wave. See, in case of perpendicularly polarized wave, what happens? E is either out of the plane of incidence or into the plane of incidence. But in either case, notice it is parallel to the reflecting surface. tangential to the reflecting surface, conductor surface. Therefore, tangential component of electric field undergoes phase reversal on reflection from the surface of a perfect. This thing we have deduced in the previous slide. That aspect we take into account, and we can sketch now electric vector here. If it is out of the board, here it will be into the board or plane of incidence. If it is into the board or plane of incidence, then it will be out like this. Now in the reflected two, we have direction of the wave propagation and electric vector's direction. Then from these two, one can find out other field direction. So using right hand rule, determine other field vectors in both incident and reflected waves. Here is shown how to sketch ray diagram in case of oblique incidence. See, wave is traveling like this. Wave direction is indicated beta I. It is perpendicularly polarized wave. Therefore, EI is out of the plane incidence. Now you know the direction of EI, you know the direction of beta I. Using right hand rule, HI can be found within no time. In the reflected wave 2, EI undergoes phase reversal. Therefore, you see here, ER is shown into the board, into the plane of incidence. This is beta R, direction of propagation of the reflected wave. HR can be computed within no time using right-hand rule, that is EH, direction of propagation. They form right-handed vector system. Electric vector can also be considered into the plane of incidence. Here, we considered into the incidence. Using same process, one can sketch the ray diagram. Now, we consider next parallel polarization. How to sketch ray and fields in case of parallelly polarized wave? Parallel polarization means electric vector is in the plane of incidence. Let us say electric vector is like this. This is incident wave. Electric vector is in the plane of incidence, slightly looking upwards. It is parallel. So now beta I is known, EI is known, HI one can find out using right-hand rule. Okay, right. So incident wave fields are, directions are available. Notice HI, it is parallel to the reflecting surface. HI undergoes no phase reversal, so its direction remains the same in the reflected wave too. Reflected wave. So HR also out of the board. Beta R is known, HR is known, ER can be found within no time. HR cross beta R gives the direction of ER. In the same way, we can consider EI downwards also. This is also the case of parallel polarization. Once EI is known, direction is known, beta I direction is known, HI can be, direction can be computed within no time. In the same way, applying the same procedure, one can sketch the ray diagram pertaining to oblique incidence of wave for different polarizations. Now here we consider perfect conductor. This is positive z direction upwards. This is y direction. At z equal to 0, surface of a perfect conductor is there. Below z equal to 0, perfect conductor. This is interface. This is free space. This is incident wave. This is EI because it is perpendicular polarization. We are considering perpendicular polarization. From EI and direction of propagation of incident wave, HI can be computed. Reflected wave can be sketched using Snell's law. Angle of reflection is equal to angle of incidence. Electric vector undergoes phase reversal. Therefore, ER is now into the board. HR can be sketched using. Now, analysis we will be doing anyway, but simple application of common sense tells that there exists a standing wave normal to conductor surface, standing wave, and there exists a pure traveling wave parallel to the reflecting surface. How? The incident wave can be decomposed into two waves, one normal to the perfect conductor surface and one parallel to the conductor surface. Normal component gets reflected in the same way, normally normal to the conductor surface. These two waves interfere to give pure standing wave, whereas the wave that is parallel to the interface, it keep on traveling parallel to the surface. No interference, no standing wave pattern, just it keep on traveling. So there exists a pure traveling wave parallel to the surface, pure standing wave parallel to the, perpendicular to the surface. Here the E vector in the incident wave is shown out of plane, but it can be into the plane as well. In such case, all other field component change to their opposite directions. In case of perpendicular polarization, certain observations can be made. In case of perpendicular polarization, total electric field at any point in front of the reflecting surface located at z equal to 0 is eta 2j ei sin beta z z e power minus j beta y by. Actually, this part, it represents wave motion, traveling wave motion, traveling wave. this part represents wave, but it is a standing wave. Here beta z is beta cos theta. This is phase shift constant along z direction. Beta y is beta sine theta, phase shift constant along y direction. This expression involves two terms, the sine term and exponential term. First one is function of z with no phase variation, indicating the presence of standing wave along z direction. The second one is function of y with no amplitude variation, but with a continuous phase change, indicating presence of uniform traveling wave in y direction. Now we consider parallel polarization. Already good amount of information is given regarding how to sketch the ray diagram. Parallel polarization means electric vector is parallel to plane of incidence. So we considered EI like this. When EI is like this and direction of propagation is available, from this HI can be sketched. One can find HI is perpendicular to plane of incidence. On reflection, HI doesn't undergo any phase reversal. So HR is also in the direction of HI. Once HR and beta R, direction of propagation of reflected wave, is known, ER can be computed. Note, EI can be decomposed into two parts, two components. So one perpendicular to plane of reflection, another parallel to plane of reflection. The component that is parallel to plane of reflection, it undergoes phase reversal. Here, in the incident wave, it is towards right side. Notice in the reflected wave, it is towards left side, indicating that phase reversal. Whereas EZ, you see, EZ is upwards in the incident wave. It is same in the reflected wave too. This is case of parallel polarization. Here, H vector in the incident wave is shown out of plane, but it can be into the plane as well. In such case, all the remaining field vectors change to their opposite directions. In case of parallel polarization, total magnetic and electric fields can be found as HT equal to HI cos beta ZZ e power minus j beta y. Of course, ET, Z, ET, Y. Total field, Z component, Y component. HT means total field. Here also there are two parts, cos beta ZZ e power minus j beta y. So this is traveling wave. So there is a traveling wave along positive y direction. There is a standing wave along positive z direction. The expressions involve sine cos term and an exponential term. The first term, function of z with no phase variation, indicates presence of standing wave along z direction. Second term, as already mentioned, it is a traveling wave. In general, irrespective of polarization and all that, we can notice certain facts. For case of oblique incidence over a perfect conductor surface. In the direction normal to reflecting surface, there exists standing wave pattern which naturally involves no average power flow. In the direction parallel to reflecting surface, there exists traveling wave and consequently a power flow. As its amplitude is distance or jet dependent, it is non-uniform plane. Its phase velocity and wavelengths can be found as V by velocity along y direction, omega by beta 1 sin theta I, V by sin theta. Here theta is angle of incidence, V is velocity in the medium, lambda y, this is wavelength, 2 pi by beta sin theta, lambda by sin theta. The field ET is 0 for all y in front of surface when sine beta z cos theta is 0 or beta z cos theta is minus m pi or m equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. Hence, a conducting plane can be inserted at z equal to minus m pi by beta cos theta or minus m lambda by 2 cos theta, m equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, without altering the pattern between the surface and plate. Such a structure amounts to parallel plate waveguide. The wave bounces back and forth between surface and plate while traveling along the direction of reflecting surface. It is a TE in case of perpendicular polarization and a TM in case of parallel polarization. While studying waveguides, parallel plate waveguides, we begin with two large parallel conducting plates. The origin of that structure is described here. Overall, perfect conductor plane surface. Important aspect is only reflection, no refraction. Because inside conductor, no wave can exist, no field can exist. In case of normal incidence, reflection quotient is minus 1. There exists standing wave pattern normal to surface, no wave parallel to surface. Phase reversal of E, no phase reversal of H. At the surface, node for E and anti-node for H. In case of oblique incidence, standing wave pattern normal to the surface, traveling wave parallel to the surface. Perpendicular polarization. At the surface, node for E. Parallel polarization. At the surface, anti-node for H. So these are some of the points as far as plane wave incidence on the plane surface of a perfect conductor is concerned. Note that perfect conductor do not exist in the real world. What we have is good conductors. So whatever all we derived or whatever all we concluded till now, assuming perfect conductor, they are applicable to the real situations to the extent that the real conductor is nearer to a perfect conductor. Enough.